IVF feels like it's under threat. If you are following the news, if you are following politics, it is all over the place recently. But the question is, if we're trying to protect embryos, if embryos have the same rights as living humans, can you do IVF without destroying embryos? Like, how can you reconcile these two things? You know, what is really going on? We're going to go over exactly what's going on. And in this video, we're going to talk about there are options for doing IVF without destroying embryos. Okay. I'm Dr. Laura Shaheen. I'm a double board certified OBGYN and reproductive endocrinologist helping people build families and do IVF for almost 20 years. I love educating. You can find lots of educational material here on my YouTube channel. I'm so glad you found it. Be sure and follow, subscribe, so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. Another great place to get information is I have a podcast, the Baby or Bust Fertility Podcast, and I come out with an episode every week. I'm interviewing people in the field. I'm interviewing fertility warriors about their stories, and I often do deep dives into topics for education and learning. Today, we're going to talk about a very important topic. How can you possibly reconcile respecting embryos and doing IVF, which is a medical treatment that many people need in order to have their families? 2% of people in the United States have been born after IVF. And in the news recently, you know, it feels like it has been under threat. So in February 2024, IVF in Alabama stopped for about 3 weeks. There was a state Supreme Court ruling about an incident in which some embryos were not handled correctly and actually fell on the floor and were destroyed. And the state Supreme Court said these embryos should have the same rights as living humans, and there could be some serious consequences for anyone that didn't protect these embryos from being destroyed. And for about 3 weeks, the IVF clinics in Alabama said, we're not sure what this means. Or if we do IVF, or we freeze embryos, or we do biopsies in embryos, if we discard embryos because of the patient's wishes, are we as the doctors or the IVF clinics going to be held liable for harming embryos? And IVF was only able to start again after an order from the governor, KIV, to protect people who are doing IVF. And IVF is back and running in Alabama, but it was a real wake-up call that legal decisions from judges can absolutely impact someone's medical care and ability to access IVF. Just in June of 2024, the Southern Baptist Convention in Indianapolis passed a resolution for the 13 million people in the United States that are Southern Baptists, saying that doing IVF was an immoral way to build your family. And their main argument, please read the proposition yourself, you know, make sure you're informed if you want to learn more. But basically, it was saying that the way IVF is conducted is not respectful to embryos, and there's got to be other ways to build a family. This is a lot. It all kind of stems from the overturn of Roe v. Wade in June 2022, kind of pushing back protections for reproductive rights and abortion to states and taking away a federal protection. And a lot of abortion legal ease is all about protecting life and protecting at the conception and basically given personhood once an egg and sperm are fertilized. So I know this is a lot of information, but it is important to understand why this is so important, why it's so heated, and how politicians and judges are making decisions that impact what medical decisions patients and doctors are trying to make. And I want you to understand where it comes from. For a deep dive into these topics and more about exactly what happened, I have a couple of resources. So I've had two really important interviews on my podcast, the Baby or Bust Fertility Podcast. The first one, episode 63, I interview Elizabeth Carr. She is the first baby born from IVF in the United States. And she was actually at the State of the Union address to sort of speak up for and try to protect IVF. And she's reflecting on exactly what happened in Alabama. And in that podcast, I do a real deep dive into exactly what happened and a timeline leading up to that Supreme Court state decision that made IVF halt for 3 weeks in February 2024. So you can really learn exactly what happened in Alabama by listening to that episode. Another really important and informative podcast interview that I did, I actually separated it into two episodes because it was so full of information. Episodes 73 and 74, I interview Barbara Calora. She's the CEO and head of Resolve, the National Infertility Association and Advocacy group that is really doing a lot to inform and educate people on impacts of legislation on access to fertility care. And she does a really great job breaking down this sort of desire to protect life and personhood bills, protecting at conception. Egg and sperm come together, and how these laws that are trying to protect and be respectful are really having implications down the road to limit access to people who want to build their families. There are many different ways to look at these issues. They are really deep and full of strong emotions. And those episodes, I think, can be really helpful to kind of understand exactly what's going on and how different people are feeling about different things. And the purpose of this video is to recognize the tension and try to reconcile between creating embryos and being respectful to these embryos that are, you're making them to help somebody build a family, but also how can you do it without creating so many embryos that people are struggling to know what to do with later. So I just want to talk about the ways that you can do IVF without destroying embryos, because I feel like that is the tension that people assume, that there's only one way to do IVF and that you are, you know, being disrespectful by creating more embryos than you need and putting people in really difficult positions. And that's really not the point. I think it's important to understand just how inefficient human reproduction is. You know, not every egg and not every sperm that becomes an embryo is destined to become a baby. And not every embryo that we transfer, even controlling for so many variables, will implant and become a beautiful baby. So sometimes it is beneficial to fertilize multiple eggs and freeze embryos so that you can only transfer one embryo at a time, because it is risky to have twins or high order gestation. And if you get pregnant, that is fantastic. You have a baby. If you don't, you don't have to go through the egg retrieval again and the shots and that whole process. All you have to do is get your body ready to transfer another embryo. And so that is the way that sometimes people do practice IVF, because it puts people through less medical risk or heartache with the shots and the egg retrieval. But you could have multiple embryos and even build a family. So if an embryo transfer isn't successful, you don't have to go through another egg retrieval to try again. Or you do have a baby, but you're coming back and you want to add to your family. You want to have more children and you don't have to go through the egg retrieval again. You can transfer embryos that have been frozen for you for years. You know, the longest an embryo has been frozen, transferred, and turned into a beautiful baby is about 30 years. It was in the UK, and this IVF was done 30 years ago, and the couple that created and froze that embryo donated it to another person who got pregnant, but that embryo was 30 years old and resulted in a beautiful baby. So sometimes people will freeze embryos as a fertility preservation model and tool. So I just want you to understand a little bit about why sometimes people do have more embryos. And again, the point of this video is to talk about how you could do IVF without destroying embryos and options that people have if they do end up with more embryos than family members that they are planning on. So there are three main options if you want to do IVF without destroying embryos. And we're going to go through each one. But the three options are, number one, you can donate your embryo and donate to someone else to try to conceive. Number two, you can do a compassionate transfer. And I'll explain what that is in just a minute. And number three, you can actually fertilize less eggs in the beginning so that you actually don't create more embryos than you know that you're going to use. There's pros and cons to this approach, but that is an option I have actually done for my own patients. So let's go through each one. Option number one, donating embryos. So this is something that I've done in my practice, and I know it's an incredible option for people, and there's matching programs, and you can honestly just do a search engine for embryo donation and come up with a lot of different resources. It's basically someone who has embryos, they're frozen, they don't want to do any more transfers to themselves for whatever reason, and they are donating these embryos to another person or family to use, transfer, and try to have a baby. It is an incredible option, and it is an option that is available. You can look up different resources online. Option number two, compassionate transfer. So this is an option where somebody can do an embryo transfer at a time in their cycle when they know that it is extremely unlikely that they're able to conceive. So when we're doing an embryo transfer, we want to do the transfer about 6 days after ovulation. That's when an embryo, a mature embryo or a blastocyst comes down and implants into the uterine cavity. If we're doing a programmed or a medicated frozen embryo transfer cycle, we build the uterine lining up for about 2 weeks with estrogen, make sure everything's perfect, and then we give progesterone. And on the sixth day of progesterone, that's when we thaw the embryo and do a transfer. If someone's doing an ovulatory embryo transfer cycle, we just watch somebody go through their own cycle. And when they ovulate, we do the transfer 6 days later. So that exposure to estrogen for about 2 weeks, that exposure to progesterone, and then the sixth day, that's when you do the transfer. If you do the transfer before ovulation, it's very unlikely that you're going to get pregnant. If you do the transfer, you know, much later, right after ovulation, you know, anywhere kind of outside of that window that I just described, it's very unlikely someone will conceive. Some people really like the idea of a compassionate transfer because they feel like they're still giving the embryo a chance. Miracles can happen. If they are meant to have a baby, then even if they're transferring at a time when they don't think it's going to happen, then it will happen, and that is what is meant to be. So the downside of the compassionate transfer is somebody is still going through a procedure. And there's a cost to the patient to do this procedure. And so there's pros and cons. You know, not every clinic will offer a compassionate transfer. It's a discussion between your doctor and your clinic, but this is something that sometimes people will do and it feels right to them. Option number three is only fertilizing the number of eggs that you want to create embryos. Like you could actually create only one embryo at a time. So remember, with IVF, our goal is to stimulate the ovaries and try to get multiple eggs out because we know that not every egg is going to be a baby. And so you can get multiple eggs out, and then what you do with them in the lab can be a discussion between the patient and the doctor and the embryologist. It's typical for us to fertilize all of the eggs that we get, watch the embryos grow out until the mature stage, until they're blastocysts, and then either transfer them at a blastocyst stage, freeze them, or sometimes people are doing chromosomal screening on embryos. So that before they freeze them, they'll biopsy cells away and freeze the embryo and then ship the cells out to be tested for chromosome imbalances. So at the egg retrieval, you can fertilize all of the eggs, or you could fertilize only one, only five, only 10. Like you can talk to your doctor about what's right for you. The reason that we typically fertilize all of the eggs is it's an efficiency model. So if you get 10 eggs, maybe eight of them are going to be mature. Only mature eggs will fertilize. If you try to fertilize eight eggs, there's about an 80% fertilization rate. That really differs with a lot of things. But let's say you have six fertilized eggs, and then you have about a 50% blastocyst formation rate. So if you have six fertilized eggs, about 5-6 days later, you might have three mature blastocysts or embryos. So you went from 10 eggs to 3 embryos. And so if someone wants to conceive, they can transfer one embryo, but they still have 2 other embryos waiting for them. And remember, that first embryo transfer might not be successful. So if you have 2 embryos frozen, then you can just do another transfer if you need to and hopefully be successful. But you can do that if the embryos are frozen without having to go through another egg retrieval. Another option is, again, if you've got 10 eggs, that you fertilize only 5. And the other 5, you freeze as eggs, okay? So in this scenario, you fertilized 5 eggs, and let's say that results in 1 or 2 blastocysts, mature embryos. And if you are successful and transfer and have a baby, fantastic. But if not, if you aren't successful with those 5 eggs that you fertilized, you could then thaw the other 5 eggs that you got and fertilize them at that point, and then see if they turn into blastocysts and see if you can have your goal met without having to do another egg retrieval. So that is absolutely an option. I have done this for patients who do feel challenged with trying to figure out what they would do with more embryos than they know that they want children. And it's important to talk about, but I'm also very transparent about that this option in the long run could be more expensive. It is a more costly way to go for the patients because there is an extra cost to freezing eggs. And then if you're going to thaw those eggs again, you have to thaw them. There's a cost for fertilizing them. There's a cost for taking them to the blastocyst stage. And so it is a wonderful option and that is available. And I have done this for patients and that is their choice. So that is an option. But it's really important to understand and be very transparent with your doctor and with the clinic. Like, hey, if I choose this option because this feels right for me, what would it cost if we needed to use those other eggs that we froze as eggs? So the reason people like this is oftentimes people feel more comfortable discarding eggs than they do embryos. And remember, embryos are fertilized eggs. So this is an option. You could only create 1 embryo at a time. You can do that now. It just might be more costly. And it's just really important to be transparent and open about that. But it is an option. So again, there is a way to do IVF without destroying embryos. You know, there's a way to keep access to this treatment that a lot of people need in order to have their families. And they can do it in different ways. So remember, the 3 options are: 1, donate embryos to other people who would like to conceive. 2, you can do a compassionate transfer. And 3, you can limit the number of eggs that you fertilize. You can limit the number of embryos you create to a number that is comfortable and the right number for you. I hope that this video has been helpful. This is such a heated and touchy and emotional topic for so many people, but I want people to understand more about the efficiency of human reproduction, why it often takes more than 1 egg and more than 1 embryo to have a baby, and to realize that there are options that are currently available now to continue doing IVF, but doing it in the right way for you. And there are ways to do IVF without destroying embryos. Like this video if you learned something, comment with questions that you have. Please subscribe, follow this channel so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. And as always, wishing you love, luck, and pineapples.